Welcome back to New World Next Week. I'm James Corbett of CorbettReport.com.
And I'm James Evan Pilato of MediaMonarchy.com. Canada quietly compensates MK Ultra victim. We got that story, plus what's not in the JFK files. But first, on this not unmitigated good news episode of New World Next Week, taxpayers hit for $650,000 after cop assaulted and kidnapped an innocent nurse for refusing to break the law. We grab this from Matt Agarest, a different take on the sort of good news of the settlement of this story. The University of Utah Hospital was thrust into the spotlight in September after body cam footage was released that showed Detective Jeff Payne arrest nurse Alex Wobbles on July 26th. One of the most astonishing aspects of the encounter was that Wobbles did nothing wrong. She was defending the rights of an unconscious patient when police demanded a blood sample from him, and the fact that she told Payne no became probable cause for her arrest. Now, taxpayers are going to be held accountable. Nurse Wobbles and her lawyer, Kara Porter, announced this week they will be settling with Salt Lake City and the university that runs the hospital for a grand total of $653,000. When Salt Lake City police claimed they changed their procedures for how police officers interact with medical professionals, it should be noted that a criminal investigation into Payne's actions was not issued until the video of the encounter went viral, as they say, over a month after it happened. According to the conditions of the settlement, it covers all possible defendants in a lawsuit, including individual police officers and hospital security officers, and the payout will be divided among the city and the university. The other good note addition to this, James, before I throw it back to you, Wobbles says she's going to use a portion of her money to help people get body camera footage for themselves in their own kind of disputed arrests. James?
Yes. So for people who don't know this story, you should go and watch the actual footage of the incident itself, because it is absolutely enraging. I remember when I saw this, when it first made its rounds, you know, a couple of months ago, whenever it was. I mean, it's just heart-palpitating, enraging footage of a nurse who is literally in her complete right, doing nothing wrong, not breaking any law, not doing anything whatsoever wrong, in fact, doing the right thing in protecting her patient, and she gets arrested for it. It's just absolutely horrific to watch. So it is good that she is being compensated. It is good that the officer directly involved in this, I believe, has been relieved of his duties. And another officer has been demoted as a result of this. So that is to the good, I suppose. It certainly could have gone a lot worse. And as Matt Agarest points out, no investigation into the incident started until there was a public outcry. So once again, public outcry is important in issues like this. But again, it can't exactly be unmitigated good news, because of course these things happen and they continue to happen, and as long as there isn't body cam footage or whatever that comes out, they happen every single day, and we don't hear about those incidents, do we? So this one just happened to be caught on camera, and thankfully it was, and thankfully it's ended up at least at this point. But then how do you put a dollar value on an incident like this, or on the concept of someone who has literally done nothing wrong, is literally knows the law better than the police officer himself knows the law, or cares about the law anyway. How do you put a dollar value on that figure? And that's something that I think we'll return to at the end of this episode. But at any rate, not unmitigated good news, but at least it could have been a lot worse.
And my friend Crimson Mist out of Utah has got the update, which we'll include in the show notes for this story, just like we include everything that we say and mention down in the show notes. Salt Lake police officer fired after University of Utah nurse Wobbles incident. And yeah, you're right. As far as enraging footage, in a year that has not seen any shortage of enraging footage, and I think we won't even see the end of it, and more enraging revelations. Our second story on this not unmitigated good news episode of New World Next Week, episode 326, we go to maybe what's not in the big JFK files. And the article that we cite comes from Zero Hedge. I like the first part of this. With much of America clicking furiously all day, you could probably just kind of stop the article right there. But it goes on to say, with much of America clicking furiously all day on the website of the National Archives, hoping to be among the first to catch the release of thousands of previously unseen JFK assassination records, they almost actually missed the deadline. James, which I know I was thinking about and kind of ruminating on my morning show. this came from the outcry of Oliver Stone's JFK film. At the end of the film, there's the title card that says, these records are going to be, you know, held away forever. It caused a public outcry. That caused then-President Clinton to write the JFK Records Act. Now, 25 years later, it's now playing out. And again, this is something I think that as you get older and you continue to pay attention, in some ways, these things get paid off, as it were, in life and in watching sort of the pop culture world. Caving to lobbying pressure by intelligence agencies, however, the Trump train announced he would not order the release of the full amount of records, instead following last-minute recommendations of his national security agencies that some of those records be redacted. During a call with reporters, White House officials explained that while some 2,800 JFK records would be released, the publication of the remaining had been postponed for another 180 days. So we'll wait and see what happens on this 180 days. One official said there's a mad scramble going on in the executive branch to get this done. So now, James, I was glad to see that you've launched a open source investigation over on Corbett Report, asking the musical question, what's in the JFK files? And what have you seen so far in your own open source investigation?
There's been a few interesting things dug up, including one from an earlier release this year that was preparatory to this release. But let's go back to this Trump releasing, not releasing the records, what was released, what wasn't released. That's an important issue, and it's being obscured in the reporting on this. So I will direct people over to the Mary Farrell Foundation, which is one of the most important websites for JFK research, all sorts of documents. They have a post up, What Happened Thursday with the JFK Records, that reads, What happened on Thursday, October 26th, with the JFK Records scheduled for release under the JFK Records Act? A travesty. Most news reports correctly noted the release of about 2,800 documents, but added that only a few were held back, in some cases saying 300 documents remain withheld. They are off by a factor of 100. In fact, tens of thousands of documents, possibly as many as 30,000, remain sealed at the National Archives. If President Trump had gone golfing at Mar-a-Lago and done absolutely nothing on Thursday, the National Archives was set to release all the documents. See the relevant language in the ARRB final report. This includes 3,147 withheld in full records, never seen, and an unknown number of redacted documents estimated at about 30,000. Intensely lobbied by federal agencies, including the CIA, Trump instead authorized the withholding of well over 90% of these documents. 52 of the 3,147 withheld in full records were released and put online by NARA, less than 2%. And 2,839 of the redacted documents were released, which is probably less than 10% of that set. And the article goes on from there, but basically what we've just witnessed is this huge psyop where that was reported that Trump had withheld records at CIA's request, and then he went tweeting, he went on this tweet spree, I've ordered the release of all documents and blah, 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 transparency, light, blah. So all the Trump followers on Twitter or whatever think that, oh, okay, it's all done. No. You've just had a psyop played on you. There are tens of thousands of documents that were supposed to be released last Thursday that were not released yet. So we haven't seen even just a smattering of a taste of these redacted documents that maybe 180 days from now we might see if we're lucky. But that should just go to show some of the confusion that's been added to all of this. Let's add another layer of confusion on top of it, because on the Deep Politics Forum and their JFK assassination board, there's this post up list of JFK assassination records missing from the archives, which lists all of these things that we know exist. We know they exist from different sources, official sources. We know they actually exist, but they are not part of the archives. They are not part of this release. They are not scheduled to be released. They're missing, or this person over here has them and isn't going to let anyone see them, or that kind of stuff. And there's a huge list of very important documents. So, again, you know, we're not looking for the smoking gun signed death warrant for JFK here in these records. We're not going to find that. Everyone knows that. So that's a bit childish to be arguing for that. But the JFK open source investigation that I'm running right now is to try to find some of those nuggets, because there are always nuggets buried in these types of stories, and it's interesting to see what kind of nuggets they'll throw out to get people at the very least to, you know, here's some nuggets, now don't look for the real treasure. So it's interesting to see what we're uncovering, and I will be writing about that this weekend for the subscriber newsletter in more detail. So, and the big background on all of this, people can go back to my earlier, back in August, I was talking about this, the background of this release, what it's about, what kind of psyop they're throwing out there. That one was called "The CIA Are Planning Their Next JFK PSYOP," so people can go to that for the kind of the background to this story.
So another kind of red herring nugget. The comment on the open source investigation that jumped out at me from Baked In Ben, as I can only assume they're a neighbor here in Oregon to me. I'm guessing things like the Hitler document are just there to distract folks from the important and still redacted JFK info. I'm willing to bet someone finds some UFO stuff in there as well. Anytime the government releases documents, it is because they can't be hurt by them, or they're trying to influence a specific group, individual, or idea. And the Hitler stuff is right in there, James, in the JFK files. The part I realized is, I think I already talked about this on my morning show back in September. There's other previous batches of declassified CIA documents reveal Hitler survived World War II with an apparent picture to prove it. So these things, again, have already been seeded out in the pop culture, if you will. Our third and final story on this not unmitigated good news episode of New World Next Week takes us up to Canada, James, where they quietly compensate the daughter of brainwashing experiments victim, as the CBC terms it. Allison Steele was only 4.5 years old when her mom's life changed forever in 1957. Jean Steele was admitted to Montreal's Allen Memorial Institute. The once happy and energetic 33-year-old was diagnosed with manic depression and delusional thinking. In the months that followed, Steele became the victim of CIA-funded brainwashing experiments conducted by Dr. Ewan Cameron. She was kept in a chemically-induced sleep for weeks and subjected to rounds of electroshocks, experimental drugs, and tape-recorded messages played non-stop. Steele said her mom was never the same. She was never able to really function as a healthy human being because of what they did to her. Now, 60 years after Cameron's experiments left her mother damaged for life, Allison Steele has finally won a measure of justice for her family. CBC News learned that the federal government quietly reached an out-of-court settlement with Steele earlier this year, paying her $100,000 in exchange for dropping the legal action she launched only in September of 2015. While, of course, a non-disclosure agreement prohibits Steele from talking about the settlement itself, the existence of the settlement and the amount was included in the most recent public records accounts tabled by the government earlier this month. James, $100,000, not really a lot of money for your life ruined, but in a lot of ways it still puts this, I think, further on the record.
Yes, and this is, I think, what I was referring to earlier when I said, how do you put a dollar figure on injustice? I mean, as enraging as the Alex Wubbles video is, can you imagine if we had video of the weeks and weeks of torture that they put Steele through? Reading from that CBC article, nurses' notes on her chart detail repeated doses of sodium amytal and how Steele would pace the hall and rail about feeling like a prisoner. It's just like being buried alive. Somebody please do something. This was all said screaming at the nurse and doctor, one note said. So she's literally screaming about being buried alive, being kept in chemically induced sleep for weeks at a time, doing all this experimentation and torture. I mean, that's what it was. It was chemical, medical torture that they put these people through. And, oh yeah, you know, 50 years later, we'll give your daughter $100,000 to shut her up, basically. No, that isn't justice. That is not justice for these types of things. And again, this is what we know about now, you know, half a century later, but what are they doing now? And do we really think that, oh, well, you know, in the 70s, this all came out and so they dusted their hands of it and they don't do anything like this anymore? No. I mean, it's just one of those things where, you know, we'll find out in half a century from now what they were doing in 2016, 17, and we'll be angry about that then. This is not justice. And this fundamentally doesn't get at the problem because, of course, no one's going to jail. No one's being upturned. The CIA isn't being splintered into 1,000 pieces and thrown to the wind, like JFK said. So, you know, business will continue as usual. It's something, and it is at least admission of guilt, retroactively, a long time later. So it's something, but it is certainly not unmitigated good news.
And we could include here, and I'm sure people have laid all these out before, all the times governments around the world admit, oh, sorry, we experimented on you. Sorry, we sterilized you. Sorry, we gave you syphilis. Sorry, we did all these things. Whoops, sorry. And it goes on and on. Now, what I scroll back up to in this article, manic depression and delusional thinking. Anybody allegedly suffering from any of that anymore? So, again, we got to be really careful about what's going on in the whole divide and conquer, rage-alluia America. Because we're going to start pointing fingers at people. No, I didn't say anything because I wasn't manic depressive. James, it's a pretty sorry excuse for a good news episode, buddy. I'm going to include here at the very end the latest episode of my own Good News Next Week. Good News Next Week is the spinoff from our Good News stories here on New World Next Week. Back in 2015, James, you and I on each and every episode included a good news story. And you and I were talking off mic before we started rolling on this that we really need to do that again. And unfortunately, there's not a lot of good news out there. So, again, we will turn to you, the audience, to give us that good news using hashtag good news next week, just like you submit stories using hashtag New World next week. So my latest episode of Good News Next Week comes on the heels of spending some time back in my family town, back in West Virginia, trading coal mines for beehives. West Virginia coal miners, trading in mines for some hives. So-called agri-hoods are just another name for victory gardens in 2017 and repair cafes. Show that mending is better than ending. And those are some of the, I think we call some of the ways that we are winning in solutions-oriented stories. James, I saw a guy in concert last night whose latest single says, I recommend that you stop watching the news. And I'd like to say here in closing that we've been exposing the so-called fake news since before it was so-called fake news. We are independent, non-commercial alternative media. We don't sell lead-tainted snake oil. We don't jump on some different bandwagon every 4 or 8 years. We don't put out all caps videos with all the latest terror porn clickbait headlines. And that's why we're still mostly underground, James. And I would again ask
and proud to be there. We remain the vanguard. We remain the alternative. And we're going to continue doing it for as many years as it takes to completely transform the world. So do it again next week.
Take care.